what someone says as their last words is what,
you know, it's poignant.
That's the salient point of life to them, right? Well, you know, Jesus did the same thing. He told us what matters most, and it's one thing. There's only one thing you have to do as a Christian.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
John, these can be tough questions, but do you know someone who's 100% in tune with God?
Now, this is a tough question. I'd have to say I've known people who are really close to and they hear God a lot. I've never known anybody that's 100% in touch with God.
Yeah, it's kind of like who got a score on the
Jesus.
SAT.
Yeah.
But, you know, 1 Thessalonians 5:16-18 tells us, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances. I love that, because I think we fail to do that so often. Mm. But give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. And what a great reminder. And it does get difficult. I got to admit that. We get into squabbles maybe with our spouse, our kids. Things chew at us to where, did we really get an A+ in how we reflect God's character? Maybe not always, but the good news is he makes a way for us to repent, to try again and do over those things that we don't do so well the first time. Today, we're going to give you a clear picture of what it looks like to do life with God, to challenge yourself actually to deepen that relationship with the Lord so that more often than not, you're responding exactly the way you should.
I like the way you put that. And John Burke is the right man to help us unpack this. He's the pastor and founder of Gateway Church in Austin, Texas. He's married to Kathy. They have an adult son and an adult daughter. And he's the author of a number of books. One that we're going to be talking about today is called Soul Revolution, How Imperfect People Become All God Intended. And we have that here at the ministry. Check the program notes for details or give us a call, 800, the letter A and the word family.
John, welcome back to Focus.
Oh, thanks for having me back, Jim.
It's so good to have you. In from Austin,
Now,
I think Amy's ice cream is pretty good.
You're right.
Hey, listen, obviously, you're a pastor, but there was a time, maybe even when you were a pastor, which is probably the core of my question, but there was that time when you really struggled with God over trusting him. I think that's every believer's challenge. I mean, Lord, seriously?
There was a time?
Yeah. If, then, those kind of questions. If you're so good, then why is this happening to me?
Yeah.
And yeah, I love that refreshing idea that even pastors have that challenge sometimes too, even though they know the word really well. So what was the battle for you in trusting God?
Well, there hasn't been one.
I appreciate that.
No, I really do think, you know, God is trying to peel us like an onion down to the core of who we are and who he is.
Why is that? What is his goal in that?
Well, I think it gets to what he really wants. But I think part of getting to that, he doesn't force us. He leads us gently, sometimes not so gently. And so my first disappointment, you know, I wasn't a believer. I was an engineer before I became a pastor. But my dad died of cancer, and I remember standing at his gravesite and looking at, you know, these two dates separated by a dash.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just looking at them, and I was thinking about how life gets summed up in two dates and a dash. You know, when we're born, when we die, and yet there's this dash in between.
Yeah.
And what's the dash for, right?
Yeah.
What are we going to make of the dash? What's it really about? And as I was standing there just thinking about that, you know, my dad had kind of defined success the way everybody defines success in our culture. You know, you make a lot of money, you have a great family, you know, take great vacations. And yet on his deathbed, he had said something to me. He said, John, I'd give it all back if I could just have my health and my family.
Wow.
And that marked me.
Yeah.
And I stood there thinking about that, and it actually led me on a journey coming to faith in Jesus, and at the same time asking the question, what is success?
Let me pull you back a bit, because in the book you also mentioned an experience with your dad about building a train, I think when you were a boy, And that had a good analogy for you. You learned something out of that. Mm. I don't know why you took so long to come to Christ, John, but I mean, what was that analogy with the train set and building it?
Yeah, when I was, maybe 8, 10, my dad got one of those HO train sets. You remember those, that electric trains? But we decided to build a Colorado-like landscape, Pikes Peak,
Beautiful.
We did. And, so we paper mache'd, we sculpted it, we laid out the track. It went through mountains and tunnels, and there were, towns and all this. And it was amazing. It took us, 5 months probably to build it.
Yeah.
And it was awesome. And when it was done, we high-fived and, we turned it on and it went around and it was amazing. But after about a month of watching the train go around and around, it started to lose its interest. And what I realized looking back is that it wasn't just the train moving and going around that was so wonderful about that. It was me and my dad doing it together.
Uh-huh. Sure.
It was us making it together. And the point for us is that there are a lot of dreams we have. There are a lot of hopes. There are a lot of ambitions. They're not bad. In fact, many of them are good. But many of them are like a finger pointing somewhere. And I believe where it's pointing is relationship. Without the relationship, first with God, and then with others, all those other things, they lose their meaning. They're just a train going around and around.
Yeah.
Just a dash between, two dates.
It's interesting because I think of people who tell the story of having that desire to make a lot of money and become a millionaire by the time they're 25, 30. And then you talk to some people that have actually done it, and they speak about how empty it was.
So that's one of the things I talk about in Soul Revolution. We all have deep longings. They're good. I think they're from God. But sometimes we have shallow strategies.
Huh.
In other words, we don't really understand how are these deepest longings going to be met. So let's say, maybe your dream is to have a family, have kids. My kids look a certain way. Things go this way or that way. That's not bad. It's a good thing.
Sure.
Right? But what if you have all that, but you still struggle with feeling known, experiencing joy, peace? Would you be okay? Or are there deeper longings still? But what if you have all those, but you still don't have contentment?
Right.
What if you still struggle with anxiety and worry all the time? And I know multimillionaires who still worry all the time.
Right.
They've told me. So our deepest longings, when we start to drill down, they're spiritual.
Right.
They're what God promises by His Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, self-control, those kinds of things. And our deepest longings only get met when we understand what God's deepest longing is too. And God's want, God's dream is for intimate relationship with you.
Let me get into that a little bit, because in the book you talk about God's longings. I don't know that I've ever thought of that other than God loves us and God built us for a relationship with Him. But I didn't carry it to the next conclusion, which is why did He do that?
Yeah.
And that's your point.
Well, and if you think about it, if God desired, if His main desire was to get people to do right and quit doing wrong, if He's God, couldn't He make us? Couldn't He force us to stop doing wrong and do right?
Right.
He could. So why doesn't He? Well, because there must be something deeper He wants. He allows free will even against His will. Why? Well, because you can't have love without free will. You can't.
Exactly right.
I mean, let's say you fall in love with some person, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you want them to love you back. You could shower them with gifts, right? With good things, but they might love the gifts, but not so much you still, right? So you can't actually buy real love. You could try to force them. I guess you could put a gun to their head and say, marry me or love me, and they might, out of fear, parrot it, but we would all know that's not love. Love must be free. That's true for God as well. And so that explains a lot of why God allows the things he allows in this world and even uses our disappointments to show us what it is deep down we really are longing for as well.
No, that is so good. You know, it's interesting, though, because we typically in the church will lean toward living a life that's more perfect, that is, you know, sinless, because it's pretty obvious in Scripture that's the goal. But the irony of ironies is the Lord is saying everything that you've just said, that, you know, you're going to learn more about me through those valleys that you go through, sinful valleys, right?
Well,
and we don't really, we don't understand that, I think, as well as we should. That God, we're not sure. We tend to think of God as like a grandfather who's shocked at our behavior, that would have never thought that you could do that.
Yeah.
But he knows everything. He knows how we behave as human beings, sinful human beings. Nothing is going to shock him.
And the other incredibly freeing truth is that the life God wants with us is so simple. It's so simple. It really is. And we don't have to work real hard. We don't have to try real hard. You know, when my dad said that on his deathbed, the reason it struck me is because what someone says as their last words is what, you know,
it's poignant.
That's the salient point of life to them, right? Well, you know, Jesus did the same thing. He told us what matters most, and it's one thing. There's only one thing you have to do as a Christian. Listen up.
Yeah.
But think about it. When Mary and Martha were preparing dinner for Jesus and the disciples, remember?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and Martha's busy, and she's frustrated with Mary sitting there listening to Jesus. And Jesus says to her, Martha, you're working so hard. You're so stressed out. There's only one thing necessary. And Mary's chosen it. Okay, so just pause. Like one, only one thing is necessary? Well, we better figure out what that one thing is and focus on that. And that is the same thing Jesus was saying his last night on earth. So he knows he's going to leave. He's trying to get it across to them. John chapter 15, he says, look, I am the vine, you are the branches. And I believe they're actually going from the upper room down to the Garden of Gethsemane. They were going through the vineyard. He picks up a branch and he goes, let me just stick it in your head, guys. It's this simple. A branch doesn't have to work hard to produce fruit. All it has to do is stay connected to the trunk, the vine, and fruit happens naturally.
Mm.
I'm the vine, you're the branches. Stay connected to me and you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do
nothing.
Some good things. No. You can build big businesses. You can have great families. You can do this and that, but nothing that he intended. Nothing that gets at the deepest longings. Apart from me, you can do nothing. So this would be the one thing. That's the whole point that I'm trying to get across in Soul Revolution.
Mm.
That actually, all we have to do is learn to stay connected moment by moment to God's Spirit, and the rest of the things take care of themselves.
Right.
And John Burke is our guest today on Focus on the Family. He's referenced the book Soul Revolution, How Imperfect People Become All God Intended. We'll encourage you to get in touch with us for your copy. The details are in the show notes, or give us a call, 800, the letter A, and the word family.
John, that's the core of the book, this idea of the 60-60 experiment. So describe what that is, and let's talk about it.
Well, let me tell you how I came to it,
okay.
Because just like anything else, many times it only comes through disappointment, like trying to get my deep longings met with a shallow strategy, and God using that to show me, how do I get what I really want with connection to him? So when we planted Gateway Church, nothing went as planned.
And here's a disclaimer. Normally with the Lord, it doesn't work out the way you think it should.
And we all know that, but when it actually hits, our response is different, right?
Right.
We had to move to six different locations during 2 years. Every time we moved, we lost people, we're reaching.
Yeah.
It was so frustrating. I'm like, Lord, what am I doing wrong? And I got to the end of myself in disappointment and frustration. And frustration with God.
Yeah.
Because he's not doing his will the way he's supposed to.
And look what I'm trying to do for you.
Look what I'm doing for you. Look at all I've given for you. And in that, he started whispering something into my mind over and over when I would start complaining for about a year, but it was the same thing every time. Am I enough?
Hmm.
Am I enough? And at first I was mad. I was like, what? I left my engineering career to follow you into ministry. I left that ministry to come plant a church to help reach people. What do you mean, am I enough? Haven't I showed? And then I realized, oh, I guess not. Because the truth is, if God, you know, loving God, loving my family, loving the people who are coming, and even with the difficulties that come, is not enough. God has to do things my way, or I get mad and angry and frustrated with him. And so what I realized in this, and this is getting to the core of this whole 60-60 experiment in Soul Revolution, is Jesus' prayer, what he taught us to pray is, your kingdom come, God, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Because God's will mostly is not done on earth, because we spend most of our time trying to get my will be done. And that includes Christians and even pastors. And so I spent a whole year just practicing waking up every morning, surrendering my will and trying to only do God's will during that day as best I understood it.
Right.
And it was amazing.
Well, and that's the challenge you put in the book. So let's talk about 60-60. What are you challenging your readers to do?
Yeah. So it came from that year of this experiment I did personally, and the joy I started to feel, the peace I started to feel, a deeper love for my children. I mean, these things that I really wanted, it was amazing. And I'm mowing the yard one day, and I'm talking to the Lord about it, and I'm just saying, I wish the people in my church could understand how great this life is with you. And I had the thought, do an experiment for 60 days. You know, it takes time to change a habit.
Right.
60 days. Every 60 minutes, set your watch beeper to go off, set an alarm to go off, or something to remind you, abide in me, remain in my love, as Jesus said in John 15, you know, and you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. So just get them to try it for 60 days and see what happens. And we did the thousands of people have done this experiment, and it's life-changing.
That's amazing.
It's life-changing.
Yeah.
But it's what Jesus said over and over, right? Paul said it in Galatians chapter 5:16, walk by the Spirit, and you won't carry out the desires of the flesh. You don't have to try to stop sinning or try to break that habit or this habit or that addiction. Just walk by the Spirit, and you won't do that. Instead, the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kind, all that will start to grow.
Yeah.
Only one thing is necessary, Martha.
Listen.
It's the one thing. So we have to learn to stay connected. So that's the experiment. I mean, just think about it. When you wake up on the typical day, how much time do you spend making your plans and thinking about how to get them done versus, Lord, what are you doing and what do you want me to do in each thought, in each moment, in each decision with my coworkers, with my children? And do we realize how much God loves us and is always with us and actually wants to guide us? That's what Jesus said in John 16. I'm going to send my Spirit. He will always be with you, and he will lead you into truth.
Yeah.
He'll lead you in the way of truth.
You know, John, in that regard, some people that might read the scripture says, you know, pray unceasingly. And you go, seriously, how do you even do that? How do you, you know, you got to go to do your banking, you got to work. How do you pray unceasingly, like you're constantly in a state of prayer? It has that feel to it, like, man, it sounds impossible to do every hour, every 60 minutes, check in with the Lord. I mean, I love it. I'm playing
I think that's a great question.
But yeah, people, really, John? I mean, really?
And that's what I like to say is, that's not what we're doing. We're not trying to beat the Muslims in, instead of five times of prayer a day, we're going to do 12.
Right.
That's not it. That's not it. It is learning to do life with this God who wants to do life with us, who truly loves us more than we can possibly imagine. And oftentimes we don't understand who God is or what he wants to give. You know, think about the woman at the well, Jesus, right?
Mm-hmm.
She was a very imperfect person, married 5 times, divorced 5 times, and living with a guy.
Right.
She was the talk of the town. That's why she was there at noon in the heat of the day rather than with the women in the cool of the day.
Right. She was by herself.
By herself. And Jesus enters this conversation with her, values her, and then he says, if you knew who God is and the gift he wants to give you, you would ask me for living water. Mm-hmm. And that's true of us too. See, she had a desire for love, but she was trying to get that desire met with these shallow strategies of men filling this deep longing mm-hmm. that only God could give. And so that's what we need to realize too. And God is so good. I mean, this is the thing, is we've got to realize how much he loves us. The Bible tells us God is love. There is no love apart from him, which means that all the love I've ever felt or given is just borrowed love. And he loves me more. And he loves you more. Whoever you are, whatever you've done, it doesn't matter. He loves you more than you love your children, your spouse, more than you've experienced love from your grandparents, your parents. It's all borrowed love.
Yeah, it's so good.
And the point of that is unless we realize who God is, and that because of what he's done for us in Christ, he did that so we will walk with him. He didn't do that just to get us into heaven one day. And believe me, I wrote about heaven. I know about that, right? That's not why. He wants us to do life with him. So that's the 60-60 experiment.
Yeah.
So what I say is, it's not stopping every 60 minutes to pray. It's not that. If you do that, it's good. It's just totally missing it. What it actually is it's trying to reorient ourselves from a habit of ignoring God most of the day to realizing that God is with us all through the day and loves us and actually wants to guide and help us.
Yeah.
In everything. It's amazing. Yeah.
No, it's so good too, because I don't even think it's a matter mostly of not wanting to. It's the distraction of life keeps exactly. us often from going deeper and settling down. It's Martha.
Yeah.
We got so much to do. Don't you know how much I got to do the dishes, Lord? I got to do all this stuff.
Right.
And he's saying, well, why don't you stop
right.
like Mary and come sit with me and hear my heart.
And I think what helps people is realizing it's not changing your life. It's reorienting your life. So in other words, you don't have to change necessarily anything you're doing, but do it with the Lord. Think about it this way. You're already going through life talking to yourself anyway. Okay, what am I going to do now? Oh, why did that person do that? Oh, wait, no. You've got this constant conversation in your head between you and yourself. Just let God in. He already knows. There's nothing we can hide from him. So just let him in. Understand that he is kind and merciful. He's not condemning. There's no condemnation for us in Christ Jesus. That's grace. So that... what? Romans 8:1. So grace is so that we can fulfill the intent of the law. That's what it says. How? By those who set their minds on the things of the Spirit, not the things of the flesh. So it's the 60-60 idea is where do we set our minds moment by moment throughout the day?
Mm.
That 60-minute interruption interrupts our old habit of forgetting about God and not listening and not necessarily being willing. And it reorients us to be able to go, Lord, how did I do last 60 minutes listening and hearing and abiding, staying connected to you? Mm. And it's amazing how you start to see God show up.
Yeah. And it's really good.
I'm telling you guys, I've kept journals of this incredible journey of faith as we walk in step with God's Spirit like this. Life becomes an adventure. Our deepest longings start to bubble up from within, not from the things without. And we look back and we go, wow, you led me on a course I could never have imagined, but it was better.
And who doesn't want that? I mean, that ideally is exactly the way we should live our lives and as believers. You know, leaning into God. This is a great place to stop, and I do want to come back next time and keep the discussion going, dig a little deeper. And what a wonderful resource, mm-hmm. Soul Revolution, the 60-60 experiment. And you've heard kind of the tip of the iceberg. And I hope you'll contact us to get a copy of John's book. And man, we'll make it easy for you. Just make a gift of any amount. We'll send it as our way of saying thank you for getting involved and being part of the ministry to help others. If you can't afford it, that's okay. We'll trust others. We'll cover it. So just get in touch with us. If you're saying, man, there's a lot in here that I'm dealing with and you need to talk to somebody, we have caring Christian counselors mm-hmm. who can help you digest some of what we have talked about today and hopefully steer you either in a relationship with Jesus for the first time or to deepen it. And if we can do that, man, we have really hit our goal of helping you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're a phone call away. Our number is 800, the letter A in the word family. 800-232-6459, or check the program notes for all the details.
John, let's do that. Let's continue next time and go a little deeper with this great content from Soul Revolution. Can you do it?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's do it.
Well, we'll hope you'll join us next time as we continue the conversation with John Burke. For now, on behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team, thanks for joining us today. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back as we once again help you and your family thrive in Christ.